So how do we start?
I mean, that's up to you. This is your idea. I mean, what we could do is we could just like, I mean, what was it? Your pitch was that it's just kind of the conversations that we usually have anyway, right?
Yeah. I bought an insane amount of stuff today because we went to the mall this morning.
Ooh,
and
what
I
do you
got
buy?
A shirt, a dress, some pants, 3 shorts, technically 2 pairs of shoes because the third pair was ordered online via the store.
Uh-huh.
I think that's all. Oh, and a new bag there. That is all.
Like for the summer or for
like
next year?
A slightly larger bag than the ones I have.
You're like a tote bag person, right?
I'm like my tiny little bag person.
Oh, yeah, you are.
But this one's a slightly larger yet relatively small bag that just fits more things.
How do you, okay, because I am a tote bag person. And like even my purse that I have is like big. So I like need to bring a water bottle around. How do you feel like you have all the things that you need for a day with such a tiny bag?
I mean, like usually I just use my tote bag because there's like school stuff in there. Cause like that's what my tote bag is mostly for. Like when I know I need to carry around more stuff than my phone and ID and wallet.
Yeah.
Okay, should we start
talking?
Yeah. Okay. Podcast stuff?
Well, who are we?
Okay, so I'm Fabiola. I'm the one who had the idea.
Well, we're both recent.
Well, who are you?
Well, yes, I need to say my name. Okay. Well, okay, we should probably say hello and welcome to It's Giving Camp. I am Saffron hefta-gaub. We are both recent Smith College graduates.
Both BA in Film and Media Studies.
We're both aspiring writers and directors.
Yeah, I am an aspiring writer, director, but I will be going to grad school this fall, Emerson at Boston.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I will be up to. Studying film.
But we both already have like a lot of ideas about the stuff that we watch and like talking about them together, and you had this idea to talk specifically about camp in the films and television.
Yeah, and so we thought it would be a good idea for our first episode to just be a kind of a descriptor slash outline for like our definition of camp before we get into the movies and TV shows.
Yeah, we want to be able to like any good academic, define our terms that we're using.
Yeah, and I did a special study last fall on camp in film, specifically films from the 60s through the 90s, and I have some stuff to read that I outlined from my special study. And so I have both a preface and a general definition of camp that I found from, I would say it's an academic source, but in the preface I write, although Susan Sontag's Notes on Camp is an incredibly important text, camp is best defined by a group of people because it is very much crafted by the marginalized LGBT community themselves. So I feel like a big reason why, like, this is a conversation and we also plan on having guests is because camp itself is a conversation. Like, it's ever evolving, and like, it just wouldn't be the same if I were just like here rambling by myself.
Yeah. And I mean, I have my perspective as a queer pansexual woman, but it's also a like my white upper middle class perspective, you know. So I'm excited to talk to many people. And
yeah. And so I also write a bit about like my outlining process for the special study, in which I write that I wanted to highlight films that I felt were exemplary to the notions of camp that Sontag had brought forth in her essay and are commonly regarded as camp, such as 1966's Batman and 1992's Death Becomes Her. I also wanted to highlight films that seem to have gone under the radar regarding their status as camp as well, such as 1974's Phantom of the Paradise and 1988's Elvira, Mistress of the Dark. And some of these movies we will discuss on future episodes. Yeah. And so the reason why I picked the 60s through 90s is because this period not only is a neat framework capping off the 20th century, but it was a period where our Hollywood studio system and the production code were dying and color technology was becoming more accessible, which meant that filmmakers could now show and tell stories that they likely would have needed to shove to the side as subtext or being up to the viewer's imagination just a few decades prior. Subtext and the viewer's imagination are wonderful, but not when that's the only filmmaking option.
I'm nodding my head. Now, here's my question for you. So if in your study you focused on the 60s to 90s and talked about how that was an era where, you know, the kind of studio system was dying, what is your thoughts now on camp in film and television from contemporary media of the last 5-10 years, when we kind of have this reemergence of like the corporate monopolies in production in Hollywood and Silicon Valley with the streaming services?
Yeah, camp is definitely harder to find now and detect because of like both the abundance of films that are like trying to appeal to every single person, therefore are likely to like not be like all that remarkable like visually or performance wise, but also because of these monopolies it's harder to like find the more like camp films and TV shows out there. But like from the TV shows that we've mentioned that we could possibly talk about, there seem to be fandom in common with all of them.
Mm-hmm. And which is my particularly, that's my specialty.
And I feel like fandom kind of lends itself to camp because it creates a bunch of like inside jokes and like different things that are like only a select group of people or have like picked up on different shows and stuff.
There's a fair number of shows that we're interested in talking about, contemporary or like recent shows from the CW network, which feel very much, well, I don't know how much is deliberate camp. It feels very naive camp, where they feel like they're trying
to produce. I'm pretty sure Riverdale is doing things on purpose.
Yeah.
There's no way they're just doing that because, oh, this is compelling.
I'm thinking about the Supernatural and the new Winchester. Because the new Winchester prequel series that they're working on, they seem to think that it's going to be a really, like, serious good show, but it looks terrible. But maybe it's just terrible. Maybe it's not even camp. Because it doesn't even look fun.
Yeah, not all camp is done on purpose, as we're going to find out.
Was there a next quote that you wanted to read?
Yes. So now we're going into the definition of camp that I used for my special study. And it's the definition used in the article, "What is Camp? Five Scholars Discuss Sontag, the Met Gala, and Camp's Queer Origins," from aestheticsforbirds.com. So the first scholar, Mirpur Quinones, addresses that the betrayal of camp is defensible if it is an effort to educate others. Because a lot of the original critique of Sontag's essay, Notes on Camp, was that because she was writing about it, it was like the secret's out, so camp is over. But as we've seen, it very much isn't over.
For this episode, I actually reread the actual Notes on Camp from Sontag, and she does acknowledge that idea.
Yeah.
Like, she kind of talks about, like, I know, like, writing about it, you know, could destroy it, but actually she's like, I don't think that's the case.
And she was right.
Camp is still very much alive over,
yeah,
God, wait, over almost 60 years,
yes,
later?
Yeah.
Insane.
So this other scholar, Quinn Miller, emphasizes that camp is more about love than it is about mechanisms of appraisal. Camp is not a tool for superiority. As Sontag notes, it relishes rather than judges. And I feel like that's really important, because a lot of, like, naive camp can be perceived as, like, simply like a bad movie that people are just making fun of. But a lot of naive camp is like, naive camp movies, when people watch them, they're absolutely not making fun of them. Like,
do you remember when we watched The Room?
Yeah.
That was so much fun.
Yeah, the Room is an interesting situation, because, like, you absolutely can make fun of it, but it's also enjoyable to watch. So it's kind of towing the line between camp and genuinely bad and laughable.
Yeah.
And this other scholar, Carl Schott Miller, writes that historically, LGBTQ people use camp's irony, theatricality, parody, humor, and aestheticism to help relieve the social stigmas associated with our identities. To Schott Miller, camp is about giving a middle finger to mainstream communities, to depoliticizing, and to co-option of subcultural practices without solidarity.
Ooh, wait, that reminds me, a quick, brief tangent, but also it's completely related. You were talking, you were retweeting stuff on Twitter this morning about the conversation around, like, the reemergence of, like, bimbofication.
Yeah, that's camp.
It absolutely is camp. And I think
especially
it's
in how it's being utilized in recent years.
Yeah, like, how do you say her last name? Chrissy, the one...
I don't remember.
Oh, God, let me look her up. I love her. Chlapecka, Chrissy Chalpica. I've only ever seen it written. Anyway, I love her. I'm obsessed with her. I want to be her. But it is 100% like, it's not reinforcing the patriarchy. It is an exaggeration that is such a performance that it doesn't. You can't look at her and say that she is conforming to that, the standard set forward by the patriarchy. It is a rebellion. It is an in her politics and in the things that she talks about, even if it is like, I just want to be dumb and hot. It's still, there is a rejection of, like, conformity.
Yeah, and, like, a lot of, like, the internet famous, TikTok famous bimbos are, like, you have to be a leftist to be a bimbo. Mm-hmm. Or else you're just, like, putting on an outfit.
Yeah, because it's not just an outfit.
Yeah.
Camp isn't just the clothes you wear, it's the way you hold yourself and how you act.
Yeah. And for these famous bimbos, it's like an entire lifestyle.
And it's a performance, too. I mean, especially online, you know. Like, we are only seeing what they
want us to see. But they choose to record.
Exactly.
Who is a bimbo? What is a bimbo? These are multiple questions that I have been getting from millennials. Who is the Gen Z bimbo? A bimbo isn't dumb. I mean, she kind of is, but she isn't that dumb. She's actually a radical leftist who's pro-sex work, pro-Black Lives Matter, pro-LGBTQ, pro-choice, and will always be there for her girls, gays, and theys.
So this other scholar, Nick Strang, writes that camp insists on dramatizes even its own unreality, its difference from the real thing, which also relates to the bimbo thing, but also to a bunch of other stuff. Like, it also, this quote also reminds me of the part in Sontag's essay where she says that camp is in quotations. It's not a woman, but a woman. It's not a lamp, but a lamp.
See, I don't know my art history very well. But what movement was the this is not a pipe thing from?
I'm pretty sure that this postmodernism, possibly.
Yeah. But it's not just that. It's like, this is a pipe, in quotes, which is different than...
Yeah.
Because you know that it's fake, but you know that it's a performance, but part of the performance is pretending it's not a performance, almost.
Yeah, like the...
Am I just saying piece. Words? Am no. I making sense?
No! Like, that piece is very much, like, showing a pipe while telling you this is not a pipe.
Well, I think that's also supposed to be, like, once you replicate it, it is no longer the thing, correct?
Yeah, and, like... It's also technically not a pipe because it's just an illustration.
Yeah.
Of the pipe. Okay, and so the final definition that I have is from Matt Stroll, who reflects on the current camp of politics, specifically the camp of Donald Trump. He notes that the reason recognizing Trump as a camp figure is so uncomfortable is that doing so is a positive, appreciative stance. Since camp is about enjoyment, Stroll argues that we can abhor Trump morally while enjoying him aesthetically, and that allowing ourselves such amusement can be a valuable coping mechanism and a decent strategy against him. And so this just reminds me of that video of him learning about Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg's death while Elton John, Tiny Dancer, very clearly blasts in the background.
It's so
the best videos of all time.
I think it's the juxtaposition, it's the contrast, because that's another thing that was mentioned when I was rereading notes on camp, is like part of camp is like the irony, and it's like the exaggeration of things that kind of come from like these two feel like two things that you have to hold at the same time. The other, like,
and like you also kind of like don't really like believe what he's saying, because he's just saying like, oh, I'm so sorry to hear that. Like, it just like it's such a weird reaction.
It feels so insincere, But he, so much of Donald Trump felt, everything he said felt insincere.
The McDonald's dinner was also camp.
Well, that's also like the abundance and the exact, you know, the.
Yeah.
Like, well, and the Donald Trump clip that I was thinking of that also feels camp is that when he him recovering from COVID hopped up on all the drugs at rallies and he's like, I could just go down there. I can't do a Donald Trump impression. I'm not going to try to do a Donald Trump impression, but he's like, you know, I can just go down and kiss anyone. I kiss man and woman. Which is so, it's so hilarious. I think, I mean, it almost like, you know, in the to talk about camp is to destroy it. It feels similar to like to explain why a joke is funny is to make it not funny anymore.
Like, I feel like I did a very poor description of the Tiny Dancer video because you just have to watch it to understand.
You just have to watch it. You just have to like, and to explain why the joke is funny.
Donald, you have Trump, to experience it, and that's like a lot of what camp is.
Well, yeah, I was also just gonna say, I think that clip is so funny because he's talking about kissing men and women when you know he just has like horrible like policies for LGBT plus people, but in that irony, it's funny. It's ridiculous. And he's so unaware. It's the naive part of it all.
Yeah. He doesn't know that he looks like a cartoon character. I wrote a bunch of notes on the Met video.
Yeah. I put it on while I was cleaning my room. So the vibes of it washed over me. The one thing that I did that did stand out that I wrote about that I was like, yeah, I love that, is their section where, what, gender with genitals, which is a bit like kind of a like extreme title, but I think that's part of the point, right, is to catch your attention. I loved the jacket with the inflatable muscles.
Yeah, I remember that one.
And then all of the outfits, where it was like, you know, things that are not things or whatever, I can't remember what their catchy title was, but like the dresses that look like items, it reminded me, I mean, that's like, feels like old school Lady Gaga, right?
Yeah, like the meat dress.
Yeah. I feel like people used to hate it.
People very much hated it.
Maybe this is just me thinking about Jennifer's body, but like, one of the things with camp, I feel like sometimes is that it's like, it's not successful, right? It doesn't do well. A lot of people reject it, actually.
Yeah, like Showgirls was mostly rejected when it came out, but now it's like one of the films in the camp canon.
Yeah, cult fandoms and camp go hand in hand, especially when one of the ways to talk about camp is the figures, you know, the inspirations, the icons who are kind of at the head of it and spearheading things.
Yeah, like a lot of like the classic camp icons, such as like Joan Crawford and Betty Davis, they're like icons because they had like massive fandoms of like mostly gay people.
Yeah, I was also thinking like Oscar Wilde to go way back.
and quite possibly the biggest one, Judy Garland, because of the whole Friends of Dorothy thing.
Mm-hmm. But is Wizard of Oz the film camp?
Yes.
Why?
Because of like all the bright colors, and it has a bunch of like glamorous female characters, but it also centers on a group of like outsiders. And there's also the very queer-coded cowardly lion.
But all of that is kind of subtext, isn't it?
I mean, like as I wrote in my special study, a lot of camp does have subtext, and a lot of it, like especially in like Hays Code era camp, it is essentially just subtext.
Mm-hmm.
It's only after the Hays Code that like it didn't have to rely entirely on subtext.
And I will say now, because I'm noticing it, we're definitely going to be focusing on American pieces, because
yeah,
that is the context that we have. But camp is an international phenomenon, right?
Yeah, like...
I mean, it's a sensibility. It's not, like, a style.
Yeah. Sensibilities don't know national borders.
Yeah. Do we want to talk about the difference between, like, naive and deliberate camp more?
Yeah, so basically, naive camp is the camp that's not being done on purpose. The performance that I think about whenever I think of naive camp is Elizabeth Berkley in Showgirls, because you can kind of tell that she wants to give, like, a big like performance that the critics will love, and that like she clearly wants to be respected as a like established actress after being like a sitcom actress.
Yeah,
but like that's not what the performance ends up being like. It's just a very exaggerated and flaily performance.
She literally flails around a bunch.
Yeah, it's a constant characteristic of that performance. And so with deliberate camp, it's the camp that like is done on purpose, and like it at least knows what it's doing, regardless of whether or not it's actively labeling or perceiving itself as camp. It knows that it's making a choice.
Mm.
And with that, I think of the other Showgirls lead, Gina Gershon, who just seems really aware of the kind of movie she's in. And like, you can just tell.
And her performance is also exaggerated, but it feels like it's exaggerated with a knowing wink.
You can tell that she's not trying to be an amazing actress, but that she's trying to have fun.
Yeah.
I don't know what all this stuff is.
I'll order for you.
Don't they have brown rice and vegetables?
Do you like brown rice and vegetables?
Yeah.
You do?
Sort of.
Really?
It's worse than dog food. It is.
I've had dog food.
You have?
Mm-hmm. Long time ago. Doggy chow. Oh, I used to love doggy chow.
I used to love doggy chow too.
I think that's such a key to camp performance. It's both fun in the doing of it and in the watching of it.
Yeah.
Which is why when I was rereading Sontag's notes on camp, I found, like, she said, the only thing that's pure camp is naive camp.
I feel like I personally would use pure and naive interchangeably, because pure is kind of like connoted with being organic, like it just happens. Meanwhile, deliberate doesn't just happen, it's like conscious. But like what I kind of disagree with Sontag is like her opinion that naive camp is more fun.
Yeah, I disagree. Because I feel like it just too.
I feel like it just depends on what it is that you're watching.
Growing up, my family loved Halloween and costumes, and my mom specifically, and then like that turned into like a love of cosplay. And my experience in cosplay, I have so much fun being exaggerated personas, characters, playing with gender and gender expression, that maybe she was just speaking from a perspective as a critic when watching or reading things. But for me, that performance that I take on is fun. And I feel like that doesn't make it any less, because I'm aware of it, doesn't make it any less camp.
Yeah.
The other good thing, at least, is that Sontag said that people could disagree with her and the definitions are going to change.
And a lot of people do disagree on her, of her opinion that naive camp is more enjoyable. Because I enjoy both of the performances in Showgirls, even though they're two different kinds of camp. They're still fun to watch.
Wasn't another thing that you talked about, one of the definitions that Sontag brought up that you talked about in your special studies, instant character?
Yes. So we will see a lot of instant character in the following episodes. But yeah, it's a lot of like with Donald Trump's appearance, like when you see him, you immediately know what he's all about. It's all about how the surface conveys an essence and how the surface, or like a lot of play, can be had.
Play. I love that word. What other thoughts did you have on the from the Met video?
Okay, so I really liked that the video and like the exhibit as a whole is like divided in different parts, and I noted that like in the different parts they go by the different grammar usages of camp. Like they mentioned, camp was first used as a verb in a novel by Molière, which it's referred as camping on one leg like a comedy king, and then camp became an adjective by the mid-19th century when it was associated with the queer community. So it kind of just became a descriptor for LGBT people in the mid-19th century.
Do you think even when it was a verb that camp is intrinsically queer?
I mean, I did get like queer vibes from the sentence camping on one leg like a comedy king.
Because it's not just like queer in terms of your sexuality, you know, it's not queer in the sense of like homosexual or transgender, in like, it's queer in like queer theory and queerness and queer idea of being in opposition to being, to challenging, right?
Yeah.
We're going to use queer in a reclaimed sense a lot in this show, I think, because that's a word that I really like. I first read Notes on Camp in a queer history class where we discussed the queer 90s, we discussed new queer cinema, we discussed the reclaiming of the word queer in the context of like the AIDS crisis. So I have like a lot of love for that word. This is just my little disclaimer in case people are upset with me. I don't know. But
I feel like people might be more upset with me because I'm technically not in the community. So.
Yeah. But I mean, you're also still using it in this kind of, like, yeah, academic sense in terms of queer theory.
Yeah. Like, I don't mean it in a slur way.
You would only call someone queer if they, in terms of, like, an identity, if that's how they already identify themselves.
Yeah.
Which is also what I would do.
So anyways, the notes on fashion video notes that Oscar Wilde is like a big reason why camp can also be used as a noun, because he became a potent vehicle for camp as a person and him being an aesthete. Yeah, he was very much kind of in the vein of like camp as a sort of lifestyle and way of existing. And I feel like camp is all verb, adjective, and noun at the same time.
Yeah. I mean, it's a feeling is the thing. Like, yes, there are things that aren't camp, and we can talk about what is camp. We're laying out this definition. But sometimes I just know what's camp and what isn't because I look at it and I feel it in my gut. And then I ask you if that's true or not. I know this is old news, but can we talk about the Critical Role Campaign 3 opener?
Yes, yes. You can explain it better than me.
Can I actually, I'm gonna pull up the tweet if it still exists. Oh my god, did he delete it?
I think you could like maybe paraphrase what he was trying to convey.
Okay, well, essentially, Critical Role, the biggest D&D actual play show that exists. Side note, actual play shows are when storytellers use the mechanics of a game to tell their story. Most cases it is a tabletop pen and paper role-playing games like Dungeons and Dragons. So Critical Role, if you haven't heard of it, that's not too surprising, but also you probably have because they had an Amazon animated show. Huge bunch of voice actors. They started their third season, third campaign. So brand new story set in the same world. And they had a new intro video where it introduced all the cast. And it was a mess. It was a mess. Visually, aesthetically, all over the place.
It just kind of looked boring. It just kind of looked boring to me.
Well, like, it was
how everything looked visually, which is the first sign that it's not camp if you perceive it as boring.
It was flat. It was also, they had like three different themes going on. And what, like, there was them sitting in reacting in slow-mo, and then there was a bunch of like bright, colorful, like explosions. And then,
like, CG explosions.
Yeah, CG explosions. And then they also had a portion where, like, clearly in a soundstage, they were, like, dressed up in little explorers' outfits and, like, walking through, like, a jungle in the style of, like, old exploring films, like, you know, The Mummy and Indiana Jones.
But not enough.
Well, some of the outfits were very much invoking colonizers. Let's just say it was
without them like being aware of what it invokes.
Yes, and people on Twitter were very much calling that out because maybe just on its own it would have been fine, but the setting that they were doing for the campaign was Swana inspired and with no people of color in like the writing production, it seemed, behind the scenes. It was a bunch of white people which people had already been criticizing, and then they do this opener. And it just felt very tone deaf. So whatever, that's a thing. There's no reason that Fabiola would have known about this unless I just, you know, I was complaining about it. But then Matthew Mercer tweets out, I don't understand, like, why everyone's criticizing this opening. You know, we're just having fun. Like, it's campy. Like, does no one understand that? Something along those lines. He said camp or campy.
Yeah, I do remember that distinctly.
And I was like, hey, Fabiola, friend who has studied camp, is this opening camp?
Yeah, like, it was really, like, telling to me that he, like, know what was exactly that was being criticized. Like, people weren't criticizing how, like, the effects looked or how the like, promo looked. They were just criticizing the context of the whole thing.
Yeah. Now, here's my question. Is saying that it's camp when it's not camp, is that camp?
If it becomes a meme. And here's where the Karlie Kloss of it all comes in. So there's this infamous Twitter post from moments before the Camp Met Gala where Karlie tweets out looking camp right in the eye with a photo of her looking in her like little hand mirror.
Anyone who's been on the internet has seen this image.
Yes.
Right?
But I'm just kind of explaining what's going on in case you somehow haven't. But while a few moments after when she like exits the hotel that everyone going to the Met stays at, it's finally revealed what her outfit is, and it's just like a boring short gold dress, and she's wearing like natural makeup, like just quite possibly the most unremarkable thing one could wear to this Met Gala. And so because of that, it became an entire meme with like the whole image being reposted over and over again over the past years. It's now arguably the most camp outfit of that evening.
So here's what's interesting. I was talking to my friend Willa about this podcast, and I brought up that photo, and she thinks it was intentional. She thinks like the whole setup of the image and then the unremarkable outfit was like a deliberate like performance.
I feel like that depends on like how aware of the entire situation you think Karlie Kloss. Like, she usually just wears basic things everywhere. Like, it's not like she is purposely underwhelming most of the time.
I will say the only evidence that she had for this was that, Taylor Swift's music videos are deliberate camp and Karlie is friends with Taylor Swift. So I think she knows what she was doing.
I feel like the Taylor Swift videos are deliberate camp. Depends on the music video. Because like when I think of Taylor Swift camp music video, I think of Look What You Made Me Do.
Yeah. Is me with the one with all the butterflies.
Oh, the me. I'm not sure because I feel like the song is naive camp because it's one of her weakest songs.
Mm-hmm.
But the music video itself, I don't know, because I feel like even though there's lots of colors everywhere, they're all muted and the whole thing is kind of in a style that isn't like particularly remarkable, even though it has like a bunch of effects and colors and everything. It just kind of lulls you.
Yeah, like there can be fun campy CGI, but that doesn't, it just feels like flat.
Yeah. The colors, baby doll, when it comes to a lover, I promise that you'll never find another like me.
Speaking of like CGI and Taylor Swift music videos, this did remind me of one thing that I've been thinking about, which is one of the things I like used to say all the time when I was trying to get people to watch Buffy, which is one of the shows we're going to discuss, because one of the things I used to say was, oh, it's campy, but you should keep watching it, which is interesting because that kind of like connotated that campy is bad, but also like I would say that Buffy is campy, but I think when in that context when I was saying campy, what I meant was the special effects are low budget.
I feel like it's all about the effort being put in, because like even with a low budget, like you can tell when like people put effort into making it. Meanwhile, like there's a bunch of like special effects movies that like you can tell that they just like slapped it together even though they have a bunch of resources.
I think what I meant was that like visually it doesn't look, it might not look very good, but it is fun. And the thing with Buffy that we can talk, we'll talk about more, is but it's got instant character, it's got irony, and it's got a lot of heart.
I think your mention of it having heart is really interesting, because I feel like a camp piece of media doesn't have to have heart. It just needs people to love it.
Ooh.
Because a lot of my favorite camp movies, by a lot I mean like the ones that I've watched, because I haven't seen all that many camp movies, the ones that I've found myself loving the most are like the more like textually hostile ones.
Coming back around to like my point that like when I would say camp or campy when I don't think I was actually understood the word, or that wasn't like, now I wouldn't use camp to describe that aspect that I was trying to describe. Do you think that, that's true for a lot of people? Do you think a lot of people use camp without realizing what it means?
Yeah, I mean, like, camp is famously, like, nebulous, and, like, it's a very liquidy and gaseous term in the sense that, like, it's really hard to pin down for even, like, people who have studied film theory and art theory and whatnot, like, let alone to like people who haven't studied film and media studies. So yeah, it's very common to refer to camp as quote unquote incorrectly or in like kind of weird ways. I feel like that's one of the reasons why, like, I wanted to make this podcast, is to, like, not just, like, clear up terminology, because I have a whole thing about, like, you are using insert term here wrong, but also to, like, be able to, like, communicate these things more and better with other people.
I have a feeling that over the course of this show, we will become like more confident in our personal definitions and being able to spot it and use it. And hopefully that can be true to people who listen along.
Yeah. I just wanted to like point out some things that I took note of from the Camp Notes on Fashion Gallery Views video. I found the definition of Isherwoodian camp, like, driving from, like, Christopher Isherwood, the writer, it refers to how camp is located in the queer world, and high camp is Baroque art and ballet and that sort of type of performance. And it was just really interesting to see those terms like defined that way.
Would you have defined them that way?
No, because I feel like with low camp, I would have maybe, like, in terms of like my modern understanding and like not from like the Isherwoodian era understanding of it, like I would classify high camp as being located in the queer world, because that realm is where a lot of camp originates and is embraced. Meanwhile, low camp is it's a kind of an amalgam of like all the things that can be perceived as being like in bad taste, as well as like the really like high echelon art where like people within marginalized groups can like notice things in it that like the people whose target audience for it wouldn't notice those things.
So you're saying that high art reinterpreted by like marginalized groups is low camp?
Yeah, because I'm kind of also like viewing it as in tandem with the naive camp and deliberate camp. Just kind of like pairing low camp with naive camp and high camp with deliberate camp.
I see. This is new information to me. So I'm excited. This is like new. So I'm excited to be learning from you.
Yeah, I'm just like, I'm not entirely sure like how much like new information that is, other than like me going, oh, that's an interesting way to categorize and define camp.
Yeah.
So a lot of the things in the video are already touched on, but I did note that it describes camp as people who are heroes but didn't set out to be heroes. And so what immediately like came to mind for me are like classic Batman, which it just has a very different energy from the Batman that most people are familiar with, which is like not only like really grounded in reality, but also seems really intentional in its groundedness. Meanwhile, you don't really get the energy of like the classic depictions of like superheroes is actively setting out to be heroes. And also I thought of one of my favorite movies, The Suicide Squad, which I do consider camp because it's basically all about people with no intention to be heroes whatsoever, but are like basically forced into being them.
Yeah. Because I feel like in some ways, if you're trying to be a certain way and you achieve it, that just isn't camp. But like,
And like now I'm also thinking about like heroism in the sense of good representation in media and how like we should like hype this up because it's quote unquote good representation. It just feels like we have to prop up this piece of media because it's trying really hard to be good and an example instead of like simply just embracing whatever type of media centering and being created by marginalized people, regardless of like how positive you perceive it to be.
I feel like a lot of, like, quote unquote good representation is just submitting itself to the dominant hegemony, like being part of the patriarchy or capitalism in a way that it's good representation because it's complicit almost. It's subdued. I don't know, a lot of like beloved examples of LGBT rep aren't even like, they're not even characters who were like necessarily intended to be like a gay icon, or they are, the character isn't even like, they aren't gay, but they become a gay icon. And that in some ways is more beloved than the background best friend who is, has a boyfriend or something. I don't know. There's, I don't want to list boring examples of LGBT rep. I want to talk about like the messy guys, just fucking around, don't care about being good examples. Because why should we be good examples, you know? This is starting to veer off topic, but
I mean, it still kind of is very much on topic, because one time RuPaul interviewed John Waters, a famous camp director, in like one of his videos, and in one moment, I'm pretty sure it's from like this video, but in one moment John Waters said, "I miss when we could be bad."
Yeah.
Well, we need a little outlaws back in the gay community, I think, anyway.
Yeah.
It's a little, we have to be so good now. I think lesbians have the right to be bad mothers, too, just like straight people. Well, it's true. Why do we have to be good all the time now?
I'm excited. I'm excited for this podcast. I'm excited to watch more stuff with you.
Yeah. I'm, like, also really excited because it's really fun to talk about movies and TV with you.
I love discussing stuff with you too. I will try not to be a pretentious film student, and I will try to define my terms when we're talking about something. But hey, if anyone ever has questions for me, my Twitter is @gaubhefta, GAUBHEFTA.
And I'm also on Twitter. It's Fabiola, FABIOLA _ Liano, LIENO. We have an Instagram and Twitter.
The Twitter is @givingcamppod, and Instagram is @itsgivingcamppod. All lowercase, one word, no apostrophe.
This was really fun. This is gonna be a good podcast.
This is gonna be a good podcast! Thank you for listening, and tune in next week for whatever topic we're gonna discuss. We don't know what we're gonna discuss next, but
there's a list.